Welcome back to the National Hockey Centre here in Glasgow on what is rather a dreary and wet day. Luckily that hasn't dampened the action at all so far, with Kelburn Ladies having already secured their National Division 1 status. What was a thoroughly entertaining encounter against Inverleith Ladies, winning 4-0. With one match now in the books, we still have plenty of action coming up over the rest of the day, with some cracking ties still to reach their conclusion. Games remaining today we have coming up very shortly, Dundee Wanderers men against Inverleith, with Dundee Wanderers leading the game 2-1. Following that, we have Grosmere and Sill Ladies winning 2-0 at the moment against Edinburgh University. And the last game of the day is Grange against Bromack Kelburn with a score tied at 0-0. We've got all that to look forward to. But just now, second game of the day is a men's playoff match between Dundee Wanderers and Inverleith, with the Taysiders holding the current advantage, having won the first leg 2-1. I'm Cheesy Dunlop, and I'm delighted to be once again joined in the commentary box by Neil Sturrock. Good afternoon, Neil.
Hi, Cheesy. Looking forward to another good game. I think Wanderers would be happy to go away with the 2-1 lead from yesterday.
Yes, I think I'll come back to this. We'll let the teams come out just now and let the stadium announcer get on with his jobs. I'll speak to you guys in a little second. Stadium announcer announced the squads there. We have actual teams in front of us. Neil, your Inverleith team is?
Well, the team we've been given, Greg McKenzie in goal, with Patrick Christie playing wide right defender, with Richard Jess and Aidan Docherty in the middle, and Josh McLean wide left. Midfield, three of Magnus Ferrier, Andy Malcolm in the middle, and Derek Salmond, I think, stepping out to the left from the midfield, central midfield role he had yesterday. And Stuart Hatton, Andrew Dane, and Joe Watterson as the front three.
And for Dundee Wanderers, we have Lewis Beer in goals, amid a defensive pairing of Elliot Sanderson and Jack Fullerton. On the right, Conor McCartley. On the left, Bruce Rowan. Midfield trio of Fergus Sanderson, Ewan Borland, and Francis Mulgrew. And up front, they have Bobby Ralph, Paul Daly, and Ross McGlashan. So the game gets underway. Dundee Wanderers in their traditional black strips, and Inverleith in their change white tops. And the ball with Fullerton at the back here. Zipping the ball over to young Elliot Sanderson, young Dundee Wanderers captain. Tries to find the evergreen Paul Daly up front, but Patrick Christie intercepts that quite easily. So Ferrier with the ball. Looks to go straight up front. Ball now back with Andrew Malcolm. He's crudely tackled there. Ball to Inverleith in the middle of the park. Malcolm steps up from that. Ball. Aid McQuaid taking that ball there quickly. The last minute change to the umpires of today was supposed to be Gavin Cruikshanks and Neil McAlpine. I think Neil McAlpine's pulled up with a dodgy hamstring and has been replaced by Martin Monaghan.
Without a dodgy hamstring?
He's perhaps got two dodgy hamstrings, I'm not too sure. And Martin himself, very good umpire. And quality player on his day as well. So this game poised just now after the first game at 2-1 to Dundee Wanderers. I'm sure after yesterday's games, the gentleman from Dundee will be far happier with the outcome. Inverleith struggling with availability. A number of their players away at a wedding. And none of them have made their way back today. I believe they're enjoying themselves at a sunny barbecue somewhere in Fife. Well, let's hope for their cases it is sunny, because it certainly isn't too hot here. So Sanderson with the ball, looks to go long, forces it slightly, lucky to get away with it. Ferrier takes it quickly, Ferrier's taken it. This is Magnus Ferrier, number four from Inverleith, looks to go long. It's a little forced ball, but does come off a Wanderer stick. It's an Inverleith ball. So Neil, after seeing the highlights of yesterday's game, what's your thoughts on today's events? What do you think might happen today with these two teams?
I think they're, I'm not going to say they're well matched, but I think they've not got their full squads with them.
As we see, Fergus Sanderson stretching away and has the first chance and scores the first goal. It's a fantastic goal by Fergus Sanderson. Picks the ball up just outside his own 25, runs a full 75 metres into the D. One shot, reverse stick, 1-0, Dundee Wanderers.
Well, Cheesy, I'm going to have to give you some credit so that the viewers are aware of how sharp we are on these things. You did say to me that Fergus Sanderson was a very quick player, and if he had room, then he would take some stopping, and he certainly did there.
It's a similar start to yesterday's game, Neil. That after about a minute and a half, Inverleith were 1-0 down. It's again today. It's just under 3 minutes. We'll see the goal here on the replay. Oh, you see him celebrating anyway, that's for sure. Obviously he was too fast. But it's a similar start with Inverleith going 1-0 down very, very early on. And that always puts the team on a sort of back foot. It's perhaps Wanderers unlucky not to get a foul there. This is Ferrier on the ball. Sturdy tackle from Elliot Sanderson. And Boland on the ball for now. Wanderers looks to go long. Oh, it's a slip there. Unfortunate slip there. Oh, I know that's not number 10, and Alan Wall, but it was Inverleith number 10. They were. So, Wanderers just trying to find their way into around the packed defence there of Inverleith. Bruce Rowan just nudging his way back there. Bruce Rowan, who I've been told to be called the gnome by his teammates. That's a little bit harsh. Certainly Bruce is one of the stalwarts of the Dundee Wanderers Hockey Club. Probably a member of their first team for the past 20 years at least.
Absolutely, and what he now lacks in pace, experience is still there.
It's unlucky. Right idea there from Dundee Wanderers. Ewan Boland just trying to pass that ball out down the right side, but nothing coming of it. So Inverleith have the ball on their left side. Put the ball up the left touchline. This is Derek Salmons, one of their key players. Just ghosts past a couple of the Dundee Wanderers players. Past Conor McCartney.
Do you think the move to put Derek on a wider position than the central one that he seemed to play in yesterday is for a specific reason, Cheesy?
Perhaps it's given him more freedom to run with the ball. Whether playing on the left or the right would have been better, I'm not sure. But Derek does like to run with it. He does have pace. He's got great skills. So maybe they're looking to maybe use that a little bit more rather than just as a holding role in midfield. Paul Daly there just getting to that ball first. The two Inverleith defenders not giving him 5 metres. So Monaghan gives the ball to Wanderers. McCartney to Boland. Boland has it, and now you've got the speedster that is Fergus Sanderson, and off he goes again. You can see him running into the D. Oh, he's panicking a little bit there.
You can see the water coming up when he tried to push that there, Cheesy. So, again, player's going to need to make sure of every pass. I think the other thing that might come into play later on in the game is the small benches that they both teams have.
This is Bobby Ralph running into the D. Inverleith under a little bit of pressure here. Nice ball across the D by Ralph, but no one there to meet it.
I don't mean by small that they're all Bruce Round's height. Small in number.
Yes. Wanderers have got three subs with them, as do Inverleith. So in the modern game, most teams tend to bring sort of 15, 16 with them, so you can rotate the players round quite quickly. The players will cover probably upwards of 13, 14 kilometres in the game when they play. So it is important to get a little bit of rest. Nice turn there by Alex Anderson, and there is room in the right if they can go right here, Wanderers. Still stuck on the left side here. That's a good tackle there by Magnus Ferrer. Unlucky not to win that ball. Sloppy pass there though by Fergus Anderson. There's one back there, well done. There's Joe Watterson. Should have a pair of fresh legs because he wasn't playing yesterday. Just a little bit too fast there. Magnus Ferrer just trying to get the game, maintaining a high pace, but he might have been better off just waiting his time there.
Inverleith stepping up on the Wanderers 16s a bit here, Cheesy, not giving them an awful lot of space to get the ball out. And pressure telling, ball going out on the right side there, and Conor McCartney not being able to control it.
So Wanderers with the ball just on their own 25 on the right side. It's Conor McCartney looking forward, looking to see what his options are. He might go with a long aerial ball, but decides to go short. It's a nice little flick by Mulgrew inside. Oh, that's not hit salmon and a sore one. It's hobbling a little bit. Dell will run that one off quite easily. It's not going to stop Derek from going. Oh, it's a missed trap there from Patrick Christie. Yes. He looks puzzled as he looks at umpire Monaghan, but we'll have a look at that in the replay. See if Patrick Christie's got an argument there.
Good early ball in with the Bobby Ralph in the circle there.
Not quite sure what the short corner was given for. Umpire Monaghan's got a better view than we do.
Unless Martin felt that his stick was too low, his hand wasn't low enough, and therefore he wasn't actually on the reverse, the edge, it was on the back of the stick.
Quite possible that was the case. That gives the first opportunity here. Elliot Sanderson at the top. Slip left is Fergus Sanderson, his older brother. You've got Bobby Ralph and Paul Daly running in from the right. So Mulgrew pulls it out, it stops, it's a flick. That's a good save there. Greg McKenzie in goal, just guiding that past the post, quickly taken. Fergus Sanderson on the ball, he comes back inside, decides to have a little dribble. Bobby Ralph got the ball, dispossessed, but it goes straight to Fergus Sanderson, who can't control it. So Inverleith have the ball back again.
Yeah, good good corner routine, good first one. Asked a question of the goalkeeper down his bottom right, but Greg McKenzie showing a bit of agility, being able to get his pad across to it.
There's a good read there by Francis Mulgrew, the scorer of one of the goals yesterday for Dundee Wanderers. But well picked out by Andrew Malcolm. Runs into Fergus Anderson and keeps on going. Again, the ball just turned over a little bit. A little bit of the story yesterday, not much of to the game, a little bit frantic, a little bit fast, not much control. So hopefully today both teams can actually bring that back and we can see a better spectacle.
Yeah, still a bit of hopeful hits, aren't there? Not real connections that people are definitely going to be there.
You see Inverleith about to make some changes. Alan Wall, Aidan Docherty and James Gray about to come on. Some fresh legs on the pitch. Patrick Christie is miscontrolling it, but running the ball back. We have Francis Mulgrew back to Fullerton. What can he do? Valdez looking at the umpire asking for a foul there. I felt he was maybe pushed over. But Salmon in the ball. Still Salmon running with it. A lot of argy-bargy. Some of the players from later on are getting in touch on Twitter. Hamish Imrie, give a shout out to the Grange players. Sitting back, watching the game in the Grange clubhouse, getting ready for his game this afternoon. Good luck to you and your team Grange this afternoon, Hamish. Also good luck to the Kilburn boys. Very impartial here in the score box, in the commentary box, sorry. And on the tweets, you can see up there on the screen, there was how to get in contact with us. I believe we have had contacts from a galaxy far, far away, Neil. Darth Vader has been in touch.
Really?
Yes.
And he's be supporting Wanderers then, is he?
I think Darth Vader is certainly on the dark side, yes. That is if you're from Dundee, the team in the dark, they are the team in the black, Dundee Wanderers. Maybe Luke Skywalker will get back in touch for Inverleith, who knows.
Good interception there from Richard Jess, I think it was, coming in front of Paul Daly. Paul obviously a danger man that just need to keep their eyes on.
Paul Daly, one of the crucial players for Dundee Wanderers. He is slightly older than some of the guys on the pitch. He has a vast amount of experience. And Wanderers have got a bit of a chance here. A great bit of speed shown. Oh, I think that was just run off the end of the pitch, yes. That was a good bit of wheels from number 13, Chris Daly. I'm not sure if that is a relative of Paul, but...
certainly as quick as.
In his heyday, yes.
And just takes his stick off the ball too late as the ball crosses the line.
It's a lovely touch there, left back. Aidan Doherty on the ball, passes that to James Gray, and Alan Wall is in around the penalty spot, just lurking. What can they make of that? Yep, short corner's awarded, it's a great bit of skill from James Gray in the byline there. Just picks the ball up nicely. I think that all came from the first touch from the left back. Well, a terrible bouncy ball, and that's a superb touch.
Yeah, it took off his legs really nicely.
Here we can see James Gray just bringing that back onto the foot of Bruce Rowan. That gives him relief an opportunity. They have at the top of the D, Neil, they have both Andrew Malwa. Andrew Malwa pushing out just now, but Patrick Christie at the top, number 13, twiddling his black hockey stick there. He can unleash the ball. A little bit too easy though, down the middle. Goalkeeper can deal with that quite easily. Lewis Beer's got no problem dealing with that, and a good save.
I think the Wanderers benefit from a really quick runner out, don't they? Putting pressure on the flicker, and they know they need to get it away very early, which puts them not having the time to pick their spot as much.
We'll see a replay of that short corner, but you'll see. I mean, the runner out is so fast, it does put the guy under pressure at the top, but it can allow for options to go around the runner. So that's maybe something we'll see if Inverleith get another short corner. A well won there by Magnus Ferrier, playing at right midfield today. Alan Wall makes a lead out to the edge of the other space on the left. Finds Derek Salmon. He lobs it into the D. A little bit of timber chopping in there. Good bit of skills by Ewan Borland. Looks to go long, if this isn't controlled, but it is.
I wouldn't say this very often, but a good tackle by Bruce Rowan there.
Derek Salmon bursting forward. No options ahead of him though, so he decides to keep the ball. Finds Josh McLean there on the edge of the D on the left. And Josh McLean just tries to get the ball into the D straight away, but just can't manage it. So Inverleith for the ball on the left side. Derek Salmon casually jogging over to take this. I think he will be one of the catalysts of the Inverleith recovery. Maybe the one urging the team on, the player that Inverleith will look to. A good defending there by Mulgrew, giving Salmon no opportunity to get that ball into the D. So again, Mulgrew just putting it under pressure. Long corner though, so still Inverleith ball. A good run here by Josh McLean, gets the ball into Alan Wall. What can Alan Wall do? Turns, drives the baseline, tries to cut it back. Magnus Bell just giving away a foul there. Good idea from Alan Wall. Just trying to drive the baseline and cut it back, but coming to nothing.
We were disappointed these days, Cheesy, that with the new long corner situation, having to take out on the 23, we're still knocking the ball 20 yards back to try and create something. I would have thought coaches would be better, have more moves set up from a situation like that.
I'm surprised more teams just don't take quick free hits and just get the ball moving. A lot of teams are slow to set up, and as you see, Ferrier's just taking that quickly and is producing a little bit of an opportunity here. I certainly know we've worked a little bit at school level about taking long corners and giving the players options as to what to do. Whether it be deflections into the D. There's a space in the right here. It's a cracking ball. If Bobby Ralph can get it, he might do. It's a good save, though. Well read by the goalkeeper. Another opportunity for Wanderers on the counter-attack there. McGrew's won it back. Borland on the ball. What can he do? Turns it over a little bit easily. Salmon mops up. Alan Wall on the ball. Just tries to find Derek Salmon. Unfortunately, Wanderers win it back. And here goes Young Daly. Using his speed. Tries to get the ball into the D, but just a little bit light with that.
I thought Bobby Ralph could have done better there. I thought he should have taken it to the goalkeeper's left, and he tries to take it the other way and doesn't quite just get the touch and to get into the goal there. I thought he could have.
It's a great bit of skill there. It's a fantastic bit of skill there. Ross Glashan just using some 3D hockey. I think Magnus Ferrier will be sitting down for a couple of minutes. I don't think you can have much of a complaint about that, Neil.
No, I think there's always a difficulty when somebody's going through with the ball in the air or you try and take that tackle. But
some of your colleagues from the Western Wildcats Hockey Club getting in touch with us, Neil Somerville. Hi, Neil. What a goal, eh? A bit like a young Neil Sturrock.
Yeah, well, he's got a better memory than you and I have.
Neil, never mind a young Neil Sturrock. He can still do that just now.
Nice to see Neil Somerville up early this morning after the University grads day yesterday.
Maybe he's just not going to bed. Like another chance coming in again. Oh, chances coming there for Wanderers. There's McGrew having a couple of bites at the cherry there, but just not taking anything.
Again, I'd be a wee bit disappointed because Ross McGlashan was at the back post there. Instead of having the shot in at the keeper's near post, Ross McGlashan standing near the far post unmarked, and all the ball needed to do was get across to him.
Aidan Docherty just failing to control that. Bruce Round gets the ball, goes back to the skipper. The younger of the two Sandersons. Elliot passes over, and Conor McCartney now has the ball. There's plenty of space here on the left if Wanderers can expose it, but here we go. McGlashan on the ball. And finds Sanderson. He's got a little bit of time. Looks at Lex to cross. And a good. Umpire Monaghan a little bit unsure about that. Been interesting to have a look at that in the replay. Sanderson crosses that and not sure what it came off. There's a wry smile on the face of the umpire, so I wish he knew what was happening. Have a look at this here. So it comes in from Fergus Sanderson on the left. And Neil, have a look at this. Is that the defender got a little touch to the goalie's legs?
Looked like it, but they've got possession again just outside the circle, so chance for Wanderers here. Ross McGlashan on it.
Just came off the goalie. That's a good deflection there from Josh McLean, just putting it out behind the goal line. Still a Wanderers ball though. It's sort of first 20 minutes, it seems that Wanderers are a little bit more up for this, a little bit more, you know, enthusiastic to get the ball, they want the ball. There's one or two of the Inverleith players maybe a little bit sluggish, a little bit slower.
Yeah, and in general, Inverleith don't seem to be able to build it up from the back through their midfield. Salmon seems to be about their only outlet, and Wanderers get it back and attack very quickly.
That's a cracking ball. Bobby Ralph another chance. Decides to wait. Second by the cherry and scores it. Yes, fantastic finish, Bobby Ralph. Took him two attempts, but that all came from the pass from Ewan Boland in midfield, which we can see in the replay.
Yeah, Ewan tricked the pocket of Eric Salmond. What I thought Bobby Ralph did very well was he actually tried to get the ball back. So there's Derek getting his pocket picked. Ball inside.
It's Fergus Sanderson that makes the pass through. A good lead by Bobby Ralph. As I think about the shot, dummies the shot, gets the goalie on the ground. A bit fortunate, but clinical with his second attempt.
Yeah, he was trying to get it back to his teammate so that he had an easier shot without having to go into the goalkeeper. So they're trying to do the right things, and then because the keeper made the save, came back to him and allowed him to get it in.
So Dundee Wanderers with the ball. Elliot Sanderson taking it. The scoreline 2-0 halfway through this first half. That is 2-0 in this game, because it's a two-legged affair, so it is actually 4-1 at the minute. So Dundee Wanderers a little bit of a cushion now to work with, a little bit of time in their hands. It's a good tackle back there though, great tackle by Inverleith. A chance to go forward with Stuart Hatton. Dumps it off to Patrick Christie, gives it quickly into Andrew Malcolm. Good, moving the ball early. Derek Sam with a bouncy ball, controls it. A few sticks waving in at his ankles. Patrick Christie coming inside a little bit. Well won back though by Alex Sanderson. Derek Salmon being strong. There's a bit of space in front of him, uses it. A chance for Inverleith. Bruce Rowan. Low, strong. Wins the ball quite easily. Salmon again. Chance to go forward. He's tackled crudely there. I've seen penalty corners given for less than that, Neil.
Yeah, and I think the Inverleith would have been a bit disappointed that Stuart Hatton didn't get something out of going along the baseline last time.
Christie on the ball, back to Malcolm. Back to Christie. Plenty of room in the middle. That's Richard Jess just passing it out that way. Derek Salmon missing it. He's off the sideline. Jack Fullerton will just saunter over to take this. He'll be in no rush.
Inverleith putting on a press to see if they can take the ball away from that sideline ball from Wanderers.
Inverleith winning the ball here. Oh, no. Not what I thought, but never mind. A little bit scrappy. Nice little pass there. Good little reverse flick from Derek Salmond. Josh McLean running forwards. Anthony, but well defended by Fergus Sanderson. Oh, well worked back though. That's great work back there by Stuart Hatton. Never giving up. Umpire Martin Monaghan's obviously seen something. Having a little word with Derek Salmond. I'm sure they won't be discussing who they're going to vote for next week in the election.
Been impressed by the two Sandersons, Cheesy. Elliot's been excellent in both his distribution from the back, but also being in the right place when Inverleith are attacking and making sure he gets the ball out of the danger area very quickly.
Yeah, yesterday was very impressive. He was very composed on the ball, and his decision-making I thought was very good. You know, he wouldn't force it. He just maintained possession. He looked to go forward. As we say that, he's just dumped it off the side of the pitch. And here gives Inverleith Joe Watterson a little chance. That's a nice little flick. Now it's 3-on-2. Inverleith have a chance here. There's options right. And he finds. Here we go. And it's a goal. Yes. Nice finish. Inverleith come back into the match. That was a nice bit of play there by Joe Watterson. A nice little flick. Hopefully see all that on the replay.
It looks like James Gray, was it, that had the final shot?
Yep. I think that was James Gray scoring the goal. But here we go. So Joe Watterson, very quick free hit. Little flick in, Andy Malcolm takes it forward. He's a 3-on-2 here. So he's got options left and right. And he decides to get his feet round, plays a pass to the right to James Gray, who controls it and squeezes the ball underneath the onrushing Lewis Beer. Or just over him. So Wanderers, a little bit of pressure now. It's only one goal in it. And Watterson, he's looking lively as he runs towards again. That's so unlucky. If it was Dundee Wanderers, they'd be trying to stop Watterson having the ball and running at you. Because the Inverleith players have been trying to get him on the ball as much as we can do. Well, it's a silly pass. Ewan Boland on the ball. He's got time to run forwards. claiming for a wee free hit or something there off a foot, but nothing. Andy Malcolm's got the ball. Mindfully still have a little bit of pressure here. Wanderers squeezing them tightly. It's a nice little play though by Andrew Malcolm. Yep, very nice. It's a sloppy ball though. It's turned over, given away too easily. Conor McCartney on the left. If someone leaves out their space on the left side here, Bobby Ralph not, or Paul Daly not too keen to lead out. North Glashan now decides to take it back to skipper. That's nice composed play. 5-6 passes to string together. Oh, and a mistrap there with Richard Jess, and it's a chance. Paul Daly's got the ball. In the D. Bobby Ralph, he's got a chance. Oh, I'm afraid you can't give someone like that that much time, that much space to score a goal or have an attempt, because he will score.
Cheesy, I think, great lesson there. Having lost a goal, as a coach, you'd be wanting your team to keep possession for a wee while. And you talked about it. Wanderers at the back played 6 or 7 passes, and then it came down the corner, down to Paul Daly. You saw young McGrew coming in. This is a great trap by Bobby Ralph under pressure, and then off his back foot, chipping down onto the ball, getting a little bit of a lift. Fantastic goal.
Here come Inverleith once again, and a chance now. It's Stuart Hatton. He's miscuing it though, going off the side. But an opportunity there for Inverleith to come straight back into the game. But a good finish, going back to that goal for Dundee Wanderers. Yeah, Bobby Ralph, as you see this run good by number 16, Stuart Hatton, into the D, has a chance. With just ball running away from him. It's just a difficult one to take.
Yeah, and Ewan Borland did a great job having his stick down there, just keeping the stick in the eyesight of the forward, so that he was worrying about that when he was trying to take the shot, put him off a little bit.
A little bit of a communication breakdown there for Inverleith. It was goal bound. I think maybe the wrong player took that deflection. Important players speak to each other. Good ball in from Derek Salmond. Del Boy. A rare mistake from Jack Fullerton. He makes up for it though. It's a long ball. Paul Daly picks it up. Now there is space ahead. Chris Daly is fast. He'll get that. But Patrick Christie is up to the task. Equally as quick. Oh, great tackle by Patrick Christie. Feeds it on. Can he get it back if he continues his run? Yes. He kind of gave up there, Patrick Christie. Needs to keep on going. Good work back from Fergus Anderson in defence.
I think that's one of the problems for Inverleith, isn't it? That when they step up and press and try and block Wanderers in, the long release pass to Bobby Ralph or Paul Daly really puts them under pressure. They've got such quick players.
Mulgrew just diving in a little bit there. Allows Josh McLean to burst forward. Derek Salmon's got the ball. He's quick. Quick free hit could be good here. There's space in the middle for Andy Malcolm. Space right as well. He's found it. There's a chance. Oh, a good tackle. Bruce Rowan.
See, now you're starting to the habit. That's twice.
Good ball over there by Richard Jess. There's Josh McLean. He finds Derek Salmon. Tries to get that ball into the D early. Pick up by Magnus Ferrier. Still Inverleith have the ball. Power over the far side awards a free hit there to Dundee Wanderers.
Good team defence by Wanderers there. Two or three of them round the Inverleith forward, and Bruce Rowan getting the tackle and then the clearance coming away.
Unforced error from Bruce Rowan though. He's turning that ball over.
Yeah, and I don't think the first time push on this pitch is actually going to go very far, so I'm not sure that's the option that they would want to be looking for.
There is space there. If you can put a scoop in here, Chris Daly could. Unlucky. Good idea.
Just having that option makes it quite difficult to defend, doesn't it? Because if you step up and then somebody just throws that ball 20 yards over the top of your midfield, then it makes it difficult for you.
Here comes Patrick Christie. Nice little lifted pass, little run from him. Fergus Sanderson have a little battle there with Derek Salmond. Derek Salmond not too happy. That's a nice bit of skill from Francis McGrew. He's taking two players out there. What can he do now? He keeps on going down, comes back inside, beats Waterson once, twice. It's good skills. Can he beat him again? Because the ball into the D. It's a chance. But good save by the goalkeeper. What was it? Was it straight into the side netting? I couldn't see from here. We'll have a look at that one.
From Martin's decision, it looks as though it goes into the side netting, but Francis McGrew showing good skills, getting a good crossover. First touch from Inverleith wasn't great, and Paul Daly got an option there, but near post with it into the side netting.
Good ball, good ball. Another bouncy ball there to Josh McLaughlin, and then lifted over his head. One might have thought that might have been a free hit, but umpires let that go.
I'm not sure whether players are getting tired or whatever, but a number of the balls now getting lifted, making it really difficult for their colleagues to control and move it on.
Ian McQuaid trying a lob ball, but not really to any effect. Andrew Dane feeling to get that back. As you can see, Dundee Wanderers showing no real urgency to take the game forward. They're quite unhappy with the scoreline as it is. 5-2. They'll just see their days out. They've got just under 40 minutes to go.
Yeah, I think Wanderers, they've got some players who are exceptionally quick and really fit, but I think the lack of numbers in their squads causing them to just be careful with what the running that they do.
I think someone could be having a seat here. Yeah. Who's that having a seat? Francis McGrew is coming for a seat down in front of us. Yeah. Naughty boy.
A tackle that is McGrew's of Dundee Wanderers' previous decades would have been recognising.
Salmon brings the ball out of defence for Inverleith. Looks forward, but nothing there. Comes right to Patrick Christie. He has options outside and his right, but goes back inside. He tries to find Ferrier there. Ferrier has a chance. He's a chance now. Oh, there's still a chance. Yes, it's a goal. A very scrappy goal, but a goal nonetheless. I think that's Andrew Dane scoring that one. A rather hopeful ball in. We'll have a look at that in the replay. Patrick Christie just lobs the ball into the goal, into the D rather. Yeah. A bit of poor defending. Here we go. So Christie just puts it in past two or three players. A mistrap there from Conor McCartney. Magnus Ferrier, wins it back. Has a sclaff at goal. And Andrew Dane is there to tidy it up and just stroke that ball home.
Does well to pick it up as it goes to the other side and out with his reach just to get a knock and get it past Lewis Beer. So game on again.
Derek Salmon, brilliant effort coming forward. It's a great run by Derek. 38 seconds to go. Let's see what Inverleith can make of this.
Yeah, I think Benny Gibson would be wanting Wanderers to just see this 30 seconds out if they can and regroup at half time.
I'm sure this ball will just go down the other end of the pitch. And lob it forward. Hold it. I'm sure Conor McCartney will just take his time. 10 seconds to go. You don't want to turn the ball over. Let's keep the ball. This first half is now petering out. Here we go. That's the end of the first half. So we enter half time with a score of Dundee Wanderers 3, Inverleith 2. Very entertaining first half, goals galore. Neil, what are your thoughts on that game?
Well, just some good skills, some basic errors in defence that have let people in to have opportunities. I think Wanderers will be disappointed that having got into some good positions to be ahead of Inverleith, that they've let them come back more by their own failures in defence than through Inverleith creating great opportunities. But I'd like to think that there's probably more goals in this game, because as the game goes on and people get more tired, I think we're only going to see more mistakes.
Right, we'll have a look at some of the goals here, some of the action from the first half. So, this is the first goal, the great steal. Oh, there's the last, this is the third goal, I think, from Wanderers. It's a great steal from O'Grew, but Fergus Anderson fitting a cracking pass through to Bobby Ralph. It was one attempt. Oh, this is the first one, sorry, my apologies. A little bit fortunate, but he's there to capitalise on it and slots it home to make it 1-0 to Wanderers. You see Derek Salmon just overrunning the ball. Boland quickly moving it on. Head up from Fergus Anderson, just lobs the ball forward into space. And a good run by Bobby Ralph.
If you look at number 11, Ross McGlashan, he's going for that drop that Bobby Ralph tries to pull back. It hits the keeper's pad just and rolls back to Bobby. Cool finish, put it along the bottom. Keeper's bottom right-hand corner. So, again, excellent skill.
Here's the first goal of Inverleith, Joe Watterson. A lovely little bit of skill. Lobs it forward, gives Andy Malcolm the options for left and right on a 3-2. And he gets his feet round and finds James Gray there, who just turns round, squeezes the ball over the on-rushing goalkeeper to make it 1-1.
Yeah, a couple of things in that, because I think Fergus Anderson dives in here that releases Andy Malcolm to get through there. Didn't really need to make that tackle. Also, when the goalkeeper comes out, he could stay up. It's by going down that he actually allows James Gray to get it over him. At that situation, you would want your goalie to stand up and just let the
Here's
guy.
Here's the second goal from Dundee Wanderers. Good trap there by Ralph. Turns around off his right foot, as you said in your comment to Neil. It's off his right foot. It's a difficult skill. I think the goalkeeper will be quite disappointed with that more than anything else.
Yeah, the ball was hit with pace. The thing that impressed me about it, Cheesy, was the position that he gets the ball from this cross from Francis McGrew. He's under pressure, but he kills that ball dead under good pressure, and then going backwards, he gets it away really quickly.
You can see
that. No pressure on him.
All three defenders, the Inverleith defenders, all three of them back straight off, given the time of day. Here's the last goal, Inverleith's second goal. I think it's maybe a catalogue of errors from both sides.
Yep.
That might not make the highlights reel of Dutch hockey's top 10 goals.
No. Hopeful ball, should really have done better with it. And then Magnus should have put this away.
Andrew Dane battles well to get that in, and all credit to him at the end. He was there, he worked hard to get it.
Absolutely, and keeps his team in the game just now.
So there you see, half-time score is Dundee Wanderers 3, Inverleith 2. Adding on yesterday's first leg, that means it's Inverleith 3, Dundee Wanderers 5. So two goals in it as we approach the last 35 minutes. And the victors retaining their position in Division 1. Unfortunately for the losers, they'll go down to Division 2. Mingus Hill from Dundee, who came up victors in National League Division 2, winning that quite comfortably, winning all of their games, scoring well over 100 goals, so they were promoted straight away. And Uddingston finishing in second place, winning last week, managing to beat Inverleith both legs to guarantee their status in Division 1, and it left Inverleith coming here to beat with Dundee Wanderers. So they're up against it in this second half.
I guess the disappointing thing for Inverleith is that the team that they've got out today is not reflective of the team that they had playing throughout the season, for whatever reasons. But Wanderers won't really worry about that. They'll just be saying, well, whatever team you put out, our job is to beat them and stay in Division 1.
Yeah, it's unfortunate for Inverleith that so many of their players are away, but there's not much they can do about it. And you are what you are, get up and get on with it. So we'll see what the second half happens. Here's a schedule for later on in the day. I see we're halfway through our second game. But coming after this is the grand finals. First of all, the ladies are up at 3 o'clock with Grove Mingus Hill against Edinburgh University. That game poised at 2-0 to Grove Mingus Hill, but certainly all to play for. The game was very even. Edinburgh University maybe have felt they could have had a few, certainly a goal in that game. And after that is the 0-0 draw from yesterday of Grange against Bromac Kelburn. So a lot to play for. Those games will decide the ranking going into the European competitions for next year.
So quite interesting, Tuesday. Grove Mingus Hill obviously ran away with the second division as the team that went down last year. It would suggest that there is a difference, significant difference between Division 1 and Division 2, and that the pace they were playing at was just too much for most of the other teams. And yet when they came and played Grange in the Cup final, they were found to be off that pace for the first division, or Cup semi-final rather. And I think Uddingston will be a good addition to the first division with Stephen Percy coaching away at Uddingston and doing a good job. They've been a very strong side for the last 2 years, and it'll be interesting to see how they get on in the first division next season.
Yeah, they're certainly a club going in the right direction. You know, they're getting their own water-based pitch at the club. You know, their youth policy is one of the best in the country. So all credit to them, they get what they deserved, and what they've got going up to Division 1 is more than deserved. Good luck to them, and hopefully they do well. So we'll wait and see as Inverleith back out on the pitch very early, 3.5 minutes to go until the start of this game. They're straight back out there. There's harsh words from Bill Robson just to get them going. Please feel free to get in contact with us. Please give us your thoughts on today's proceedings. Please tweet us in at Scottish Hockey and hashtag Hockey Playoffs on your thoughts of the day's events, what your thoughts are, maybe who's going to win what game, who's going to score the goals, who will be key players, who won't be key players. There on the screen you see, I think we're watching some of the Edinburgh Uni ladies coming in on the far side there on your screen. That's Squidge Campbell. I'm not sure if that's Waverley Miller with her, I'm not sure. Well, there are some of the girls that are playing next. Some people watching the game, coming back from perhaps a wedding in Fife or going to Fife, watching, listening to the game, and it's Heather Crichton. Hello, Heather. Glad you're watching us. Hope you're enjoying it.
So it'll be an interesting half time for the coaches, Cheesy. I think Bill Robson might be reasonably happy with the way the team played, but not on the number of chances that they created. And so I think he'd be looking for more connections from the midfield to the forward line and trying to get more clear-cut opportunities. Wanderers have probably had more of them, and they'll just be looking to cut out the mistakes in defence that have allowed Inverleith to be as close as they are. But fitness, I think, is going to tell in the next 35 minutes. And we've said before about the limited number of players on the benches. I think Inverleith have used all of theirs, but certainly Mungo Hay hasn't been on from Dundee Wanderers, so they're restricted in what they've done so far. And with all due respect to Bruce and some of the others, they're not as young as they used to be, and the questions that will be asked are going to get tougher as it goes on.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. Inverleith obviously having to push forward now to try and get an equaliser. Dundee Wanderers do leave someone very, very high, so if they really push forward too much and leave people exposed at the back, there's always that little chance of a quick smash ball down the pitch, pick it up and you're left with a one-on-one. So it'll be interesting in the second half. I think it'll be a little bit more open. I certainly don't think we're finished in the goal scoring stakes either.
Well, it's similar to the women's game, isn't it, that we said that if Inverleith stepped up to press, then the opportunity for Kelburn to take advantage of that and play through to their quick midfield and forwards. And there's a similar situation here with the forwards that Wanderers have, and with Fergus Anderson in the midfield.
Just don't forget, Wanderers starting off the second half with only 10 players. McGrew still in the sideline, still in the sin bin. Inverleith get the second half underway. Bob Ralph running forward to put under pressure to Jess. Andy Malcolm in midfield. A little bit of room, a little bit of time. Nice pass out wide. Stuart Hatton picking up back to him. Andy Malcolm. Bob Ralph just chasing back. Now there's a bit of time here, a bit of space. What can Inverleith make of this? Yeah, so there is not too much.
That's wanders back to 11 players, but Bobby Ralph looks as though he's struggling a wee bit just now with injury, not moving as freely.
Derek Salmon unlucky there. So Conor McCartney with the ball, finds Fergus Sanderson. Fergus, a little bit of time. You don't really want to let Fergus Sanderson turn and run, I guess. You want to get him under pressure. Again, it's a hopeful ball forwards, not finding anyone. He's giving the ball back to Inverleith. Lob it forwards. Good bit of skill there from Conor McCartney, picking that one up. Nice and tidy work by Elliot Sanderson. Yeah, Elliot Sanderson, for someone so young, to be given the captaincy of a team like that, it's quite something else. And to carry it away with the way he's done and the manner he's played in the last two games has been very impressive.
Absolutely. We've got a lot of good young players coming through in the Scottish youth system just now, and I think to see someone able to cope with what's getting thrown at them in a game like this and command it and direct it is outstanding.
Bruce Rowan with the ball on the left side for Wanderers. Finds Fergus Sanderson, gives it back. And he's bided their time, comes round the back to the skip. Pass it back to Fullerton. Oh, who just forces the ball. A little bit too much from Derek Salmon there. No way Ferrier was ever going to catch that one.
Yeah, I'm surprised that Jack Fullerton went for that, because the ball out to Conor McCartney was always likely to be intercepted because of the proximity of the defender to the line of the travel of the ball. We'd expect him just to go back and take another shot at it.
Sandy Malcolm in the middle of the pitch here. There's options on the left for Inverleith if they choose to do it, but they choose to go back the other way. And there is a little bit of space on the left. Andrew Dane making a run. Bruce Rowan reading it very, very well. It's a nice pass though. Finds Paul Daly. Good tackle by Patrick Christie. Takes it back. Finds Richard Jess. Andrew Dane. It's a good tackle. Francis Mulgrew. Now Ewan Borland. Nice little dummy, if that was his intention. Now here comes Derek Salmon to Andrew Dane. Three against three. Just a little bit too easy.
Well read by Elliot Sanderson again. Just in the right place, the right time.
Patrick Christie with acres of room out there on the right, hits it in, and it's nobody even trying to get the end of that. Everyone is standing still.
Still not sure that Bobby Ralph is fit and able to do a full shift, and I think I might be looking to bring Patrick Christie into the game a bit more if I was in Inverleith and see if you could work that.
That's a good tackle with Stuart Hatton, nice little pass inside as well. James Gray just trying to feed it, or is that Joe Watterson, sorry, just trying to feed it back to him, but it's not coming off. And here is Watterson, nice little bit of skill there, finds Derek Salmon. Derek Salmon's got an opportunity to come around the D here. Ferrier wins it. Yep, long corner to Inverleith. Nice little play there by Joe Watterson.
Yeah, I mean, that's two or three mistakes Jack Fullerton's made in the last 5 minutes. Just need to be careful.
Here's Christie with time on the right. Come back inside. Ferrier's got it. Well, it could be a corner there. A contretemps between Patrick Christie and Bobby Ralph. I think I know who might win that battle. So here we see Ferrier taking it round. Perhaps unlucky not to get a corner there, but trying to beat the goalie at his near post, as I said already in the commentary, it's probably not the right thing to do.
They obviously haven't been listening to us.
Out with here, the view on the screen there, both Patrick Christie and Bobby Ralph laughing about it and shaking hands. It's good to see. It's It's a long ball from Wanderers. It's relieving pressure. I'm trying to encourage Wanderers to step up a little bit higher. I think if I was Inverleith, I'd probably look to try and take these 16s free hits a little bit quicker. I'm not sure Wanderers would be that quick to set up.
Yeah, I agree. And if you look at where Patrick Christie was, he was wide open at the wide right defensive position. So
Derek Salmond surges forward. It slips. Oh, a great bit of skill from Derek Salmond. Keep that under control. Finds Andrew Dane. He's again just trying to find a foot to win a short corner. Maybe he wants to be a little bit more positive and have maybe a crack and goal. But
Ewan Borland's having to do a lot of shuttles with Derek Salmond just now, and it's not something you want to do for the next 27 minutes, 29 minutes.
We want to do it for 2 or 3 minutes, never mind 29. Thankfully they don't do that at Vets Hockey.
Inverleith setting up to press Elliot Sanderson if Bruce goes back, so he's having to throw it forward again.
Inverleith want to reshape at the back. Three. Josh McLean in the ball. Usually wants to be a little bit more speedier into position. He's a little bit hesitant.
If they can get the ball to the wide right, they've got Patrick Christie in.
Yeah, he's found him, but it's a little bit too late. If you get the ball back to Andrew Malcolm, if he drives left, there is room in the left wing position. I think Stuart Hatton's realised that. Now if you can release that ball forwards. Fortunate that that's been let play on, I have to say. Umpire Gavin Cruikshanks is letting that go. Certainly a look of disbelief from the Inverleith bench that wasn't a card.
And having had one already, I don't think Wanderers would want to go down to 10 players for a longer period.
Aidan McQuaid passes out here. Josh McLean. Aidan Doherty leading towards the ball, which is not coming. Andrew Dane not able to keep it in. It's a bit of a sloppy pass though. So Joe Watterson running up fast to try and put Elliot Sanderson under pressure, but not being backed up by people putting Bruce Brown under pressure. I've really got to go and hunt in packs rather than ones. It's a good run by Bobby Ralph.
That's the threat that Wanderers have, isn't it? If they can get the ball down there, then they've got the opportunity to attack the circle and attack the Inverleith defence. So we've got a tweet from, looks like Mrs. Gibson. Hi Neil, Wanderers are doing great. Must be the coach that's on the bench that's making the difference. Well, Marlon, he's been pretty quiet so far.
Yep, short corner there. Good little bit of skill by Andrew Malcolm, lifting up over Bruce Brown's stick and then Bruce Brown lifting it back up into the unrunning Andrew Malcolm. So there's an opportunity for Inverleith to claw their way back into the game here, make it 3-3.
Yeah, Bruce will be disappointed that he didn't get his reverse stick on that and it went to Ewan Borland and bounced up off his stick. But again, this is what we said, Wanderers need to be a little bit more careful in their defending because that's how most of Inverleith's opportunities are coming. So, two set up at the top circle, Derek Salmond on the stop.
So, Andy Malcolm with injection, Salmond stopping. Christie at the top, here comes Christie. I think he quite got hold of that one as it slipped past the right post.
Yeah, but if you look how close Alex Anderson is to the flicker when he's releasing the ball, it must be really difficult for the guy because he's under pressure.
Here we go, and it's Ross Glashan running forwards into the D. The chance, a great pass across, it's unlucky. Good defending though by Inverleith.
Umpire giving it for the wrong side of the stick because the left hand wasn't low enough, so it wasn't the edge, it was round the back.
I'm thinking Mr. Mulgrew could be sitting in the side here, Neil.
Yeah.
Yes, I think that's a rather, not just a 2 minutes, a cumbersome tackle.
I think we called that a couple of minutes ago, and the coaches or the players are shouting press, but if you're not going to get there, it's, you've got to be careful.
So Inverleith for the man extra. I wonder if they can make use of that. Will they send a forward up there on their own? Stretch the game a little bit to try and create some room. Will they double team the ball when they don't have it to try and put the Wanderers players under pressure? It's Alan Wall winning the ball back. Very well done by Alan Wall against Bobby Ralph. Good strength in there by Alan Wall. It's unfortunate not to get anything from that. Inverleith maintain possession of the ball. Plenty of space out on the right if they can look at. Aidan Doherty making a good lead right out in the right wing at your screenshot there. Creating space inside for everyone else. Andrew Dane is forcing the ball a little bit though. Yeah, it's poor play by Andrew Dane. No need to make a tackle like that.
Yeah, I was sort of disappointed, like you, that when the ball did go out wide right to Patrick Christie, there was a good lead from the forward onto the baseline. And I would have liked to have seen Inverleith with players on the baseline just now when they're one player up.
Right, Fergus Anderson with a little bit of room. Looks to go long. Finds Paul Daly. A lovely little bit of skill from Paul Daly. A little bit dangerous, but... I'm giving it back to Wanderers though. I think obviously he's deemed that the Inverleith defender wasn't five from the pickup. We have a look at this in the replay here. You can see the ball comes over. Nice little bit of keepy ups over the attacker's head. Great bit of skill. Unfortunately, to no avail.
I don't think it was as close as actually the defender made it look in the end.
So Wanderers driving down this left side. Maintaining possession, he's quite happy to come back out and go round. They've still got a two goal cushion overall. Score 3-2 today, but from 2-1 yesterday. They've still got that two goals. They can sort of have a little bit of a cushion. Roll that ball into the side there, but no one leading out to get it. So far, Inverleith not making any benefit or creating anything with this extra player that they have. The Wanderers will be quite happy with what's happening. There's no urgency from Inverleith. They're just passing the ball about.
Don't see any pattern leads in the midfield, Cheesy. No real key decisions or key leads from people to get on the end of the passes.
Derek Sam, man on the edge of the D here. Aidan Doherty, but it's that bouncy pass. This goes awry. Maybe attempt to find Inverleith to play against 10 men. Maybe go to three at the back, except someone's a little bit higher up. They seem to still be sitting with four defenders back there, just happy passing about the back. But
and Bobby Ralph asking Benny Gibson to sub him because he's struggling at the moment. That's just going to add to Wanderers' issues.
Certainly lip read quite easily. I can't repeat what Bobby Ralph said as he came off there. His general just was, crikey, I'm tired.
When the Wanderers have the ball at the back four, Jack Fullerton's so wide that the ball from him to Conor McCann is really difficult. It's a single channel ball, makes it an awful lot easier for Inverleith to mark, but also it doesn't give him the options to the midfield and the base and the long one down the line. So could view him being a little bit closer. A
sloppy pass though from Richard Jess, and it gives Ross Glashan a chance to come forwards. One back though, good tackle, good vision there by Derek Salmon finding Magnus Ferrier. forced into the D just when they had a little bit of an overlap on the right. They had time to go around the right side. They just tried to force it into the D, but she's given away it again. So a second bite of the cherry. Duncan Rosick's getting in touch via Twitter, commenting on how we've been saying Benny Gibson's been very quiet and how times are changing. He's been a model professional down there on the bench. So 20 minutes to go. Scoreline 3-2, the Dundee Wanderers. Inverleith really needing to push forward and get something from this last 20 minutes. Two goals would be sufficient to take it into extra time. Christie with a long corner. A silly ball now. It's 3-on-2. 2-on-1 in the middle. If Chris Daly gets his head up, you can see Fergus Sanderson is wide open. This is poor control. Umpire blowing his whistle and is sending somebody off. He is sending Inverleith's Richard Jess, I think it is, off. We'll have a look at that again. So a few stick tackles, I think, as far as umpire is concerned. It's now Inverleith's turn to have 10 players. I wonder what they can do with only 10. It's a little bit too easy there from Wanderers. And Paul Daly's making a run.
Coach's nightmare, players trying to hit through the opponent for somebody who's making a run round the back.
I think he's... Yes. Oh! Inverleith coaching staff in front are going bananas. Now, Fergus Sanderson is rapid, and I wonder if this is a time he should use his pace. Bobby Ralph. Oh, just misses the ball. Sure, that's a free hit. Umpire lets play rave on. Glaston's got the ball, finds Borland back in the middle of the pitch here. No options other than just to thump it into the D. And Inverleith clear the danger, but give it straight back to Bruce Rowan. He plays a 1-2 off the Aidan Doherty stick. Glaston back to Sanderson.
Yeah, great drive by Fergus Sanderson. Again, good control by Bobby Ralph, but totally misses the ball when he goes through.
So Wanderers with the ball, Bruce Rowan just biding his time, looking around, seeing what the options are. Decides to pass it back to Fullerton. Well read though by Derek Salmond. Derek urges his team to go forward, launches a high ball. Good pick out there. Andrew Dane first to that. Tries to beat two players at once, so it's just not going to happen.
Yeah, good defending by Ewan Borland. He took the high ball down and then... good tackle to get it back.
Well, that's a good run by Andrew Dane. Just unfortunate not to get anything more from that.
Wonder if Flair doing well, covering their feet in the circle, and then I think it was Conor McCartney that actually managed to get the touch.
A few more people getting in touch with us on Twitter. Chris Grassett watching from down south, I think. I know you'll be supporting the purple robes, Christopher, and Stephen Dick. Thank you for your chat there, Stephen. I'm doing my best. So Inverleith with the ball. Patrick Christie feeds it into the middle. Derek puts it back. Derek Salmond leads again to get it. Doesn't get it. There's a chance down the line if Derek leads. And he did, but the ball was a little bit slow to come to him.
There's almost no midfield for Inverleith now, apart from Derek Cheesy. They've got a back four. And almost a front four. and Derek in the middle. So it's a lot easier for Wanderers to pick up stray balls.
There's Chris Daly here. He has a little bit of wheels. He's got a bit of gas. Good work by Patrick Christie, though. Nice to slow Daly down there. Now, Fergus Anderson, head up, looks up, drives into the D. This is dangerous for Inverleith. Good goalkeeping. Oh! Umpire blew his whistle perhaps a little bit early there as Conor McCartney was wound up.
Yeah, I think as a coach you'd be wanting the umpire just to hold his whistle just a moment.
It's a good run there though by Fergus Anderson. He drew in, what, three defenders there, four defenders and the goalkeeper. And the ball came back up off the defender's stick. This is now a chance for Dundee Wanderers to stretch their lead.
Yeah, I think Bobby Ralph was hoping that he didn't shoot as she was the only one on the line. Yeah,
as he's just seen the replay there, he was put his hand up to say thank you. So, Mulgrew to push out. Borland to stop. It goes to Fergus Anderson, who takes it on his reverse. A little bit unorthodox. Maybe not one that many teams would use, but to no avail. Inverleith making a few subs beneath us. Joe Watterson coming back on. He's looked lively, Neil. I've been impressed with what I've seen from him. And if Inverleith have got any sort of prospect of getting back into this game, I'd maybe suggest they use him a little bit more.
Yeah, they've got to get the ball forward and give the forwards an opportunity. Ooh.
Inverleith with Watterson. Oh, gets a crunch. I'm not sure why that perhaps hasn't been given a corner. It has done. Yeah. I think the umpires have spoken over the microphones to decide that was a short corner.
Yeah, there were two or three things there that I think could have been picked up. I wasn't sure that Francis Mulgrew's tackle was as bad as the crowd thought it was, but certainly Fergus Anderson's one could have been a corner. But I think Martin gave it for a shoulder.
It's much to the relief of the Inverleith fans, who are a little bit frustrated with the umpiring, perhaps.
Yeah, well, 30 minutes to go. If they get this, then the game's back on again.
Yeah, good goalkeeping there by Dundee Wanderers goalkeeper, Lewis Beer. Well worked corner, but stout defending. Sees that one away.
I'm not sure the rules, GC, but are you allowed to continue playing the ball with your mask on after it goes out the circle?
I've had many many discussions about this with some of the umpires around the country about when you're allowed to stop or start playing the ball or whatever it is and when you have to take them off by. And I'm not sure that any of them actually know the real rule.
Okay.
My guess might be just be it's a safety thing, as long as it's not dangerous. Obviously, last week we saw an umpire get a crack in the nice stitches in the side of his head because of a Grange player throwing, who's standing actually not too far from us, Rob Barr over there, decided to throw his mask off last week and it managed to hit the umpire in the head. He had to go to hospital for stitches in his eye.
Yeah, I heard it wasn't quite as bad as the black eye that his wife had given him, though.
That was just to match the other side.
But it makes it really difficult when you've got the mask on, the corner, the ball goes outside the circle if they're asking you to have the mask off to take part in the game.
I guess so long as it's not dangerous, there's not really any. If you see Christie coming forward, nice little bobbly pass there to Derek Salmon. He's got nothing really on looking forward at all. A lot of people just standing still, expecting Derek to do all the work, but it's a nice pass from Andrew Malcolm. Finds Patrick Christie a lot of room there, but Patch was not able to do much. It's now the Wanderers number 13, Chris Daly, trying to find Bobby Ralph up front there, but this is not coming off. Tactical change there from Bruce Rowan. As he's getting on in life, the stick's obviously getting too heavy for him. He's a lighter bat. Good pass there, good width in the lead as well, but easily dealt with by Conor McCartney. He finds a good ball down the line. There's Bobby Ralph using his pace. maintaining possession of the ball there on the right side as Inverleith defend. It's unlucky. Good ability there by Bobby Ralph.
That was an excellent tackle by Conor McCartney down on the right baseline when Inverleith were attacking, covered everything and very difficult.
It's an early ball in there by Fergus Anderson, but off the feet, I think, of a Dundee Wanderers player first of all before it hit the Inverleith player. 10 minutes to go. Still Inverleith 2, Dundee Wanderers 3.
Inverleith pushing their front three very high now, just about on the Wanderers 23, and then looking to try and bring it out from there. Still reliant on Derek Salmond a lot though, aren't they?
Yeah. Good work though, good work back there by Inverleith. Stuart Hatton working well, but just not coming off for him. The Wanderers maintaining possession of the ball. Conor McCartney just biding his time. Quite happy just throwing it off the end of the pitch.
I think he was looking for a lead outside when the ball, when somebody else led inside, and the second part of it wasn't there.
Again, Derek Salmond leading into midfield. It's the Inverleith fans beginning to chant on the side here. They can inspire their team as Derek Salmond surges forward. It's a good bit of skill. I thought that might have been a foul there myself. The umpires have waved play on. Again, Inverleith players are fans are up in arms with that decision, or lack of decision.
Yeah, I think it was difficult because the ball didn't really change an awful lot, but it hit Francis McGrew's foot and then went on to Wanderers player.
It's Wanderers number 10, Francis McGrew, involved in that again. He's been at the core of one or two bits of action this afternoon. Somebody says perhaps a little bit lucky not to be, or still to be on the pitch. Received a yellow card earlier on and has made one or two strong tackles, let's say. That ball should have gone in front there of Borland. Paul Daly using his knowledge leading ahead there. That's a poor pass out there from Richard Jess, giving Andrew Malcolm no chance.
Yeah, it was asking a lot of questions, wasn't it? Andy Malcolm of a tackle there on Francis McGrew trying to come through. Now Fergus Anderson going down the right touchline, getting a crossover, but
rather weak really attempt.
Yeah, not getting hold of it. Immediately the Inverleith forwards hit the Wanderer 23.
Yes, referring to a tweet coming in from Stephen Dick. I'm not sure what the music selection is. That's nothing to do with us here. That's been run by Scottish Hockey. If you've got any preferences, Stephen, please let us know. We can surely ask. We can get something of your choice. Maybe a bit of Beethoven or Mozart for you. I'm not sure what it is, but here we go. Inverleith on the run. A good run by Andrew Dane. That should be a short corner. Umpires are giving a free hit. Derek Sam takes it quite quickly. He's not going to sit about and moan about anything. He's going to get up and get on with it. Chance here in the D. Magnus Ferrier gets it in, controlled by Alex Anderson, and just lobbed down, and here's McGrew happy just to smash the ball down the pitch.
Yeah, Martin Monaghan had a look across at his colleague there to see whether there was a corner. Certainly came off Ewan Borland's foot as it came back, but quite rightly it was outside the circle.
There we go. Gavin Cruikshank stopping the clock here. He's coming to have a word with Bobby Ralph from Dundee Wanderers. I can't really speak Dundonian, so I'm not sure what they're talking about down there. The game starts again. McGrew. So Fergus Anderson's got the ball and steps off, leaves it for Conor McCartney. He lobs it down the line, but a little bit close to the forward, who's beginning to push him under pressure, which is what they should do. Now, yet again, that's Francis McGrew getting involved in the thick of things. You better have a watch of what he does.
Yeah, Stuart Hatton did well to cut that down and make it dangerous.
Inverleith fans are baying for blood down here, Neil. That's the blood of Francis McGrew they want. Here's a run from Derek for Inverleith. Derek Salmon just unlucky. But again, just wanders, just thumping it out the pitch. A little bit panicky. Ferrier drives in. That should be a short corner. Yes, that's a short corner. Good idea by Magnus Ferrier there, just getting into the D as early as he can do. Sometimes these bouncy passes that come into the air are pretty hard to deal with.
Yeah, when it's bouncing like that, it's really difficult as a defender to get control of it right away. And Elliot just lifts it up and makes it dangerous.
It's Andrew Day in the chest. So, with 5 minutes to go, Inverleith really need this to count. Can they make this matter? Out it comes. Stopped. Andrew Malcolm. Oh, off the post. A great effort by Andrew Malcolm. Here's Derek Salmond. Drives round. What can he make of this? Good little squeeze past. Wins the free hit. Moves at five, so it can come into the D now. Lifted over. Ferrier gets it.
I'm not sure that corner didn't have a touch save from a defender before it went onto the underbar.
We'll look at it again in the replay soon. It's end-to-end stuff. Inverleith on the back foot now. Look at this corner.
Corner comes Fergus out. Sanderson. Good drag flick. Might have been and the keeper that touched it, but see it again from here.
I think it's the guy in the line.
Yeah, I think it's Bruce Roundstick.
Yeah.
Excellent save.
Can't have been a high flick then, that's for sure. Ewan Borland just tidying things up. Now here's Francis McGrew. And Ferrier leads ahead. Looking good from Magnus Ferrier. Unfortunately, just takes a touch there from Ewan Borland. Ferrier still has it. Oh, it's a keenest crime. How that isn't a short corner and a card, I have no idea. I certainly know that if Francis McGrew wasn't a Gavin Cruikshank's Christmas card list, he might be now.
Yeah. I can't believe that Francis is not learning from what's happened before, because he just seems to be diving in, and certainly a penalty corner and likely a card as well.
So Inverleith back defending in their own 25 now. Quick free hit. Here comes Patrick Christie, who finds Alan Walt, and there's space to go forward. Now Inverleith have a chance. There's options left and right. Left in the D, here we go. A chance. Surely a short corner, yes. But there, I think Ferry had a little bit more time than he thought. He was a little bit rushed, a little bit panicky there.
Yeah, he could have held on to the ball. I think he also had a pass at the back post. But that was more like it for Inverleith, managing to pass the ball across and down the side and finding opportunities to get clear people in the circle. Good ball from Alan Wall. Release off there. And then, yeah, had a lot of time. And again, near post shot.
So, out. Dundee Wanderers breaking the line. Now that's Elliot Sanderson breaking the line. That's their speed merchant away.
Well, would you not change your back three and put Fergus Sanderson back as your first runner?
Oh, that's a bad push out. Christie's got it. That's a little lifted pass. Oh, it's a great save. Oh, I thought the goalkeeper got a touch on that. I think Inverleith are thinking that as well. Have a look at that in the replay. I thought the goalkeeper has made a fantastic save on that one. The umpire's given it against. So a little pass out from Patrick Christie. Perhaps a little bobbly. Derek Salmon gets it and the bobbles up. And Andrew Day with a sort of reverse stick upright. That's a great save.
Absolutely.
Obviously too quick for the umpires there. You can see it again from the behind the goal. Comes in. Andrew Day. Good save from the goalkeeper.
Yeah. I think the thing for me is having this strategy of, if your first runner has to go at the halfway line, do you have another quick first runner? And of course Wanderers do.
It's a free hit to Wanderers on the edge of the D. I think now time is beginning to run out a little bit much when it's given up, upgraded to a short corner. Umpire on the other side of the pitch has given that as a short corner. And that, I think, could be that. I think that could be the end. I think Inverleith, with less than a minute left, needing three goals to win.
Yeah, no matter what outlet breakout pattern you have from the penalty corner defence, you might score one, but it's unlikely you're going to get more than that.
The rain is still coming down on us, unfortunately. It's beginning to get a little bit smurry, as you can see on the screen there. The camera behind the goal. Here we go. Elliot Sanderson at the top, stopped by Borland, slip left. Here's Fergus Sanderson, flicks wide of the goal.
I'm not sure why he's lifting that. He's got two guys for the deflection at that back post, and Paul Daly and Bobby Ralph.
Turned over very cheaply by Inverleith there. Good idea from Patrick Christie, but he's forcing it a little bit. If Wanderers get any sense, it's unlucky. I would have just taken that ball to the side, but I think that's it. Time is time. Hooter's about to go, and there we have it. Dundee Wanderers winning this second leg of the game. 3-2, and overall winning 5-3, which sadly for Inverleith means they'll be relegated to Division 2. And for Dundee Wanderers, it means they maintain their status in Division 1. A very close match, but end-to-end, as you see, a lot of devastated players out there. Neil, what's your thoughts on that game there?
I haven't seen Wanderers much this season, Cheesy, but I was really impressed with Ewan Borland in the centre of midfield. I thought he did a power of work, both offensively, but also in tracking Derek Salmond and trying to make sure that Inverleith couldn't build the ball up into midfield. I thought Bobby Ralph, Paul Daly, the front line with Ross McGlashan, the front line of Wanderers were always threatening, and so it kept the Inverleith defence on their toes all the time. They were having to cover that, and when you have Fergus Anderson coming down one side and Francis Mulgrew for the time that he's on the park coming down the other, both quite quick. And with Elliot Sanderson at the back, I thought they controlled the game. And Inverleith might feel aggrieved at some of the umpiring decisions, but I'm not sure they can be aggrieved at the outcome.
No, I think they're right. There's one or two decisions that didn't go their way, but you're going to get that in any game. I just wonder how much missing so many players has had an effect on them. I don't think if they had their full team here, the result may have been the same. I think it would be somewhat different. But all credit to Dundee Wanderers, they've come out, they knew what they had to do, and they've had a game to do it, or two games to do it this weekend, and they've done it, so all credit to them. I think now we'll have a chance to look at some of the action, some of the moments in that second half. Some of these players just disgruntled, walking off the pitch, here we go. And actually, here's Joe Watterson, this is Inverleith's second goal. Nice little bit of skill, as you said yourself, Neil, three defenders came up. That one pass took three defenders out. Andy Malcolm, quite easy to find. It's forward up there. And that was James Gray just squeezing that over the goalkeeper.
I think the other thing I would say is if you watch Elliot Sanderson, put on to the other goal for next goal for Wanderers rather than seeing that one again. So Francis Mulgrew coming in. Nice crossover. There's Bobby Ralph. Just takes it away from the defenders. Chops it off his back foot. And I think the keeper would be a bit disappointed with that. And maybe it's a game of two keepers, because I thought the Wanderers keeper made some excellent saves.
This is Inverleith's second goal. It's a catalogue of errors, both for both teams. And eventually being squeezed in or rolled in by Andrew Dane. The back post in there. Sadly, that goal couldn't inspire his team to anything more than that. As the game petered out in what was a bit of dismal conditions out here, finishing 3-2 to Dundee Wanderers. However, next game up ahead of us will be Grove Mingus Hill against Edinburgh University in the ladies' grand final, followed at 5 o'clock by Grange against Kelburn. That concludes our coverage of this match, but it's not the end of the action. As you see later on, we've got two more games, so we'll be taking a short break. I'll be back in a few minutes for live coverage of the second leg of the ladies' grand final, Grove Mingus Hill against Edinburgh University. I hope you'll all join us then. Thank you.